tomorrow against Carolina. He has a sore ankle. Mike Holmgren wants Brown to be ready for the first playoff game in January. And Terrell Brandon, doubtful for tonight's Bucks-Heats game after rolling his ankle Thursday against the Cavs.
That's going to do it for us. Gary Miller, Stuart Scott at 11 for a full hour. For Bob, I'm Reese. Heisman Show now.
The following is an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Four finalists, symbols of college football excellence. Soon, one will carry the title Heisman winner with each future step.
Close your eyes now and listen to your heart call and the echo within will call my name.
Energy of New York City with a little extra current flowing through the Big Apple this evening. Within sight of Lady Liberty, standing guard in New York Harbor, our focus is squarely on another famous statue. We're coming to you from the shadow of the World Trade Center's Twin Towers on the southern tip of Manhattan at the respected home of the Heisman Trophy, the Downtown Athletic Club. Up on the 13th floor, the regal setting of the Portrait Room, folks here have scored some of the toughest tickets in sports every year. We are extremely proud you could join us on ESPN for the announcement of the 63rd Heisman Trophy winner presented by Wendy's. Very soon, this famous fraternity will have a brand new member, and soon a new portrait will hang alongside Blanchard and Davis, Griffin and Dorsett. On the base of the classic bronze stiff arm runner, a new name will be engraved, and 1997 will forever be known as his Heisman year. Now, the next hour here is a fun one. It's a salute to the seasons of all four Heisman finalists. They are Ryan Leaf, the tough guy junior quarterback from Washington State, led the Cougars to their first Rose Bowl in seven decades. Peyton Manning, the lone senior here who celebrated finals season at Tennessee, produced more records, but more importantly, an SEC title. Charles Woodson, the driving force behind the nation's best defense, Michigan junior with phenomenal flair as a three-way impact player. And Randy Moss, the sophomore receiver coming off a history-making season at Marshall, an unheard-of dominance at his position. The 97 Heisman Trophy finalists. They're all here as individuals tonight, but all of them will tell you they represent teammates and coaches and loved ones who've helped them become what they are, the best in college football. They are not here because they focused on or lobbied for awards. All of them did their talking on the field and made those around them better. Each of their teams won at least 10 games, won a conference championship combined. They were 42-4. Many Heisman winners held onto their ballots until the last minute. They said this was their toughest decisions ever. A good percentage held on to them until after the conference championship games. That's a similar percentage to last year's voting. Now, with some insight on the key aspects of the Heisman electorate, 870 media types, and the 51 living former Heisman winners, here's Mike Adamly. Mike?
Well, Chris, to summarize the Heisman balloting, the nation is divided into six regions, the Northeast, the Mid-Atlantic, the Midwest, the South, the Southwest, and the Far West. Now, voters in each region must select three players on their ballot. The first choice receives 3 points, the second choice, 2 points, 1 point for the third place vote. Now, the point system was adopted to eliminate any regional bias. Now, once the ballots are received, they are then tallied by the accounting firm of Deloitte and Touche. And the player who receives the most points, not the most first-place votes, receives the Heisman Trophy. Chris, and I think it's fair to say that in Heisman races that have been very close or where there has been a lot of indecision, those second and third-place votes have been very, very critical.
Well, I agree, and also regional factors. Last year, recall Danny Werfel and Troy Davis split the six regions. This year's Final Four has a little bit of a different feel to it. A prominently defensive player, a pure sophomore receiver from a school in its first year of Division 1A football, plus, for only the third time in 63 years, we don't have a running back. A cause of concern for the guys from the glory days. What happened? Archie, Tony, Mike Rozier, 73-83, 11 straight Heisman trophies went to running backs. Up next, we'll visit with the first of the four finalists. Until now, no player from the Mid-American Conference had finished higher than eighth in a Heisman vote. But then Randy Moss has made a lot of us rethink what's possible at the 1A level. We'll visit with a 25-touchdown man when we come back on Heisman Night 97.
Are you looking for that red-hot gift this holiday? That gift that's hotter than hot. That special something that's on everyone's list? Then come to Wendy's and get a spicy chicken sandwich made with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. Heat up your holiday with Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich. And while you're there, say hello to Dave.
You can watch the Wendy's 3-Tour Challenge on ABC Sports December 20th and 21st.
So I'm back.
There's certainly no wearing much.
I know.
In my town.
Hey, lady.
What is 24-7?
24-7 is
24 hours a day?
7 days a week.
You want to trade hats? Is this real Dalmatian?
Watch your back. Oh, very nice.
Everything all the time.
We're here to please. Thank goodness you're here.
David?
I don't think so.
I can't believe it.
Oh, man, these fishnets are riding me. Vegas, I'll see you next month.
This is no ordinary toothbrush. This is a Braun Oral-B plaque remover. The Braun Oral-B Ultra. Its ultra-speed oscillating brushing action removes plaque better than a manual toothbrush. That's not our opinion. That's clinical fact. And its unique cup-shaped brush head cleans even below the gum line. Dentists recommend changing your toothbrush every 3 months. We suggest you change it forever. With the Braun Oral-B Ultra.
I believe in the power of the beer vendor. That one man with one beer born in the Rockies can refresh thousands. I believe in the perfect pour. Frost brewing. Cold beer, warm heart. I believe that the three most important words on earth are hey, beer, man. That if a vendor can't get you your Coors Light at its ultimate refreshment level, it's a darn shame. And I believe in comfortable shoes.
Heisman Trophy presentation is presented by Wendy's Delicious Spicy Chicken Sandwich. It'll make you feel warm all over.
Welcome back to New York City on Heisman Night 97. You know, every defense that faced the thundering herd had the same Marshall plan, the same pregame mantra, no Moss, no Moss. 60 minutes later, they were saying no Moss. The touchdown-making talent of Randy Moss was like a force of nature. You could plan for it, you could prepare for it, but you could not prevent it.
Whenever he stepped on the field, Randy Moss was boss, a transcendent talent so effortlessly dominant, he seemed to be thirsting for a greater challenge, the height and hands of a classic possession receiver, but the speed to score from any spot. Marshall teammates say just knowing that Randy was on their side gave them faith and confidence as they moved up to Division 1A. And in the MAC championship game, Moss was the difference, taking over the snowy second half with a trio of touchdowns. From day one, Double Eight drew double teams constantly, but consistently beat them for touchdowns in an NCAA record 27 straight games. He caught 90 passes, but still averaged more than 18 yards per and scored from beyond 70 yards five times. Only Jerry Rice accounted for more touchdown receptions than Randy's 25 this season. And his freshman total of 19 touchdowns also ranks in the all-time top five. Randy's two seasons at Marshall produced a national championship in Division 1A, then a MAC championship, a bowl bid, the most wins ever by a program moving up to 1A, and a 25-2 record. Lee is with one guy who's sure glad he got to Marshall the same year as Mr. Moss.
Yes, and that's Bobby Pruitt, the head football coach at Marshall. Bobby, you've coached a long time. How does Randy compare with some of the players that you've coached and even some of the players you coached against?
He's the most phenomenal athlete I've ever been around. He's just,
He's 6'5", 210 pounds, runs 4.25. He's got a vertical leap of 40 inches. He's got great hands. He can make you miss when you catch the ball. He's just great.
You know, some people question the competition level that Randy faced. How do you answer that statement?
Well, you know, he's always been the best in any level he's ever played on, high school through college. And he can't account for who's playing against him. He just goes out and makes plays.
How has Randy's presence helped the other players at Marshall?
Well, I think he's raised their level of expectation, their level of performance, because they see the things that he can do. They nicknamed him the Freak because he does so many freakish things on the field. He's just outstanding.
Well, Bobby Pruitt, congratulations on a great season. Good luck at the Motor City Bowl. Chris?
Bobby was telling us the story last night. Randy's freshman season got talked into running track, went to the Southern Conference indoor meet, won the 200 meters in a 21.15, one of the fastest college times in the country on one day's practice. He's back with Kirk.
All right, Chris, thanks a lot. As you mentioned, I'm with Randy now, and Randy, obviously an incredible year this year. And looking back throughout your whole career since you got out of high school, is it a big night just to be here, the fact that considering all these obstacles that you've had to overcome?
Oh, yeah. Being up here in New York is... I'm fortunate and blessed to be up here chilling with Leaf, Manning, and Woodson. It's been great. So we're just up here just having fun.
I know throughout your life, your mother has been a huge influence on you. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that for us.
Well, I think just, my mom just being raised by a single parent with two other in the family. I think I just owe all the credit to her and with her prayers and, you know, just guidance throughout the years just got me here today.
Chris, this is incredible. You averaged 2 touchdowns a game for the entire season. You mentioned the double coverage. Did you look at that as a welcoming challenge, or did it become frustrating to you?
I think it's more of a challenge. I think if you see double and triple coverage and you still can find some way to score, then you're out there doing your job. So I think that's what I try to do is get out there and score and do my job.
I know you don't like to get caught up on what level of competition, but it's got to feel good knowing in your mind, and you talk to players such as Ryan and Peyton and Charles, you know you can get it done at any level in your mind, I would think.
I feel that I'm just a ball player. You know, I'm not a cocky ball player, but I just go out there and do what, you know, what's expected of me. So if it's the block to spring the running back, I'll do that. If it's catch the ball in the end zone, I'll do that. So I'm just there to do what I'm expected to do.
You had a great year. Congratulations. Good luck tonight.
All right.
All right, Chris?
Well, it's kind of hard to express what it means to a program like Marshall until the last couple of years, basically best known for a tragic plane crash back in 1970, now to have Randy Moss here, a West Virginia native, to boot. Randy had more catches for more yards and more touchdowns than any of the three receivers who won the Heisman Trophy. Sorry, Johnny Rogers, Tim Brown, Desmond, Moss has got you. Maybe we can settle a running discussion all week. We'll clear out these chairs. We'll have our two quarterbacks exchange reps here. We'll see if Charles can cover Randy Moss one-on-one. That's the matchup everybody in the country wants to see. We're going to visit with Michigan's defensive glove, who's had a hand in just about everything the Wolverines do. When we come back on Heisman night, he would be the third Michigan man to win the Heisman, following Tom Harmon in 1940 and 1991's Desmond Howard. Who can forget when he struck the pose? We're coming back.
It's the Great American Outdoor Store. Bass Pro Shops Outdoor World Chicago is now open in the Gurney Mills Mall. Just in time for the holidays, choose from a mountainous selection of top quality gear for your favorite outdoor activities. Your whole family will enjoy the fabulous outdoor atmosphere. Don't miss the new Bass Pro Shops Outdoor World Chicago. Now open in the Gurney Mills Mall on I-94.
Hey, let's switch over to Web TV. Let's see what they thought about our game at USA Today.
There's no need.
Let's see who's going to be traded.
No, thank you.
Okay, how about fantasy football?
No.
Soap operas.
Web TV, now where TVs are sold.
I hope she really finds happiness. I do.
It's the most wonderful week of the year. There'll be tailgater hostings, kielbasas for roastings with people you don't even know. There'll be Hail Mary stories and tales of the glories of bowl games from long, long ago. It's the
National Car Rental Bowl Week.
only on ESPN.
Of the year.
Here he is on the best football team in the country, the best defense in the country, and he's far and away the best player. Nobody would ever have to apologize for voting for Charles Woodson.
A Michigan man showing his true maize and blue loyalty. There's another group of folks who have closely watched Charles Woodson's Heisman run. The defensive players, anybody who's ever tried to tackle one of the offensive glamour boys in his career, well documented that no player who plays predominantly on defense has ever won this award. Now, a couple of them have come close, of course. Hugh Greene of Pittsburgh back in 1980, he was a one-man wrecking crew, dominating for the linebacker position. He was the runner-up to George Rogers. He's been the benchmark for defensive players. He had 197 first-place votes back in 1980. Holy Cross's two-way crusader Gordy Lockbaum dazzled Heisman voters enough to secure his second top five finish, a third to Tim Brown in 87. As one defensive finalist, Warren Sapp, pointed out in this room a couple of years ago, that Heisman Trophy does have a football in his hand, but then Charles Woodson's had a football in his hand occasionally this year, and when he has done plenty with it. Something that confused the Michigan coaches, Charles came to Michigan wanting to play defense. Secondary coach Vance Bedford said he couldn't understand why when he watched his first drill as a cornerback. He thought there's no way this kid is ever going to make it. 4 months later, he was going man-on-man against the top receiver in the country, Terry Glenn of Ohio State, as a true freshman and making two interceptions. Number two had arrived. The man with the rare flair, a triple threat of astounding talents. First denying big plays, then delivering them.
Hey, I make plays. That's all I do. They do all the talking. I do the walking, man.
Scraping the sky to swipe a pass or slicing through a defense to snare one. Charles Woodson conjured moments that seized momentum for the Maize and Blue in a few well-chosen seconds that burned into our memories forever. With the Buckeyes in the Big House and the Rose Bowl in the balance, it was Woodson's individual brilliance that propelled Michigan to Pasadena. Receivers found getting loose against the deuce almost impossible, and calling him out imprudent. Direct challenges to Woodson's side were rare, but he still picked off seven passes, second most in 1A. Against Charles and company, receivers rarely ran far, averaging under 9 yards per completion, a new all-time low. Quality, not quantity, defined his offensive impact, averaging more than 18 yards per touch and scoring touchdowns as a receiver, runner, and returner. During the sleepy summertime in Ann Arbor, the guy who was running the stairs in the Big House all the time, getting ready for this season and for triple duty, is back now with Kirk.
All right, Chris, as you mentioned, with Charles, and Charles, there's been so much talk this year about getting it done on both sides of the ball. It used to be in college football, this was the norm. Starting to get back into that a little bit now in the 90s. What's the most difficult thing in the 90s playing on both sides of the ball?
Well, I think the most difficult thing is just being in great condition. And that's why I work so hard in the summer, running those tough steps in Michigan Stadium, just trying to stay fit, basically, you know, being able to play all those plays. You have to do that.
You know, for a lot of players out there, their first few steps of stardom maybe begins at the peewee level out in the football field. For you, it was, I guess, in the living room with your older brother. I know you're very appreciative of those times and him spending a lot of time with you as you guys were growing up.
Oh, yeah, I needed that. You know, my mother wasn't there all the time because she worked a lot, worked those hard hours, 12 hours a day. So I needed somebody at home with guidance. And me and my brother used to get together in the front living room and just go at it. I used to try to beat him, and, you know, he never took it easy on me. And I think that's what helped me develop into the type of player that I am today.
You know, it seems like when kids grow up, when they're younger, they want to be a quarterback, they want to be a running back, a receiver. But now in college football, there's such a premium of good, top-notch corners, and the style of defense is a lot of man coverage. So corners like you are being more showcased. Do you think kids now, after tonight, are going to grow up wanting to be the next number two, Charles Woodson?
Well, I'm not sure that they'll want to be me, but I just think with the type of game that I play, trying to do so much for the team, players will just see that and know that, you know, if they work hard, you know, they can be anything they want to be, play both ways in football or basketball or whatever. All I want to do is go out there and show them that I work hard, and hopefully they'll follow that.
You nervous or excited?
I'm excited. I'm having fun.
You guys beat Duke today in basketball. Maybe that's an omen.
Oh, yeah. I want to say what's up to that Michigan basketball team. I see they pulled it through, so I'm going to try to bring home a Heisman for you guys, hopefully.
All right, buddy. Good luck.
Right.
Congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
All right, Chris.
None of these guys say they're nervous. They're all big-game players. Charles admitted last night to me, he and Terry broke a whole bunch of couches in that living room in the apartment growing up. You can add broken couches, broken lamps to the already impressive list of Charles Woodson statistics. It's tough to kind of quantify the impact of a corner. You might have to factor in the tackles that a safety can make because it didn't have to help out on a receiver. Different types of stats to compare. That's what made this Heisman race very interesting. Now back to those broken couches and the woman who had to pay for them and the woman who had to try to cover Charles Woodson in the young years. She's with Mike.
Well, Chris, to paraphrase, behind every great football player, there is a nurturing, caring mom, a woman who has to wear a lot of hats, from disciplinarian to cheerleader. Georgia Woodson, one such woman. Georgia, when did you begin to realize that Charles had some special talent, that both had the mental and physical wherewithal to not only win a scholarship to a major school like Michigan, but also become a college All-American?
Well, early on, I realized that Charles was going to be special because we had him in flag football for the YMCA, and he would always want to run the ball and pull the flags.
You know, you sacrificed so much of your life for both of your sons. Tell us a little bit about the most important times in that your household, those Saturday nights with the ham sandwiches on the living room floor.
Well, we would have family discussions, and if there was any problems going on in the home, we would sit down and have a family-style picnic in the middle of the room floor, and we would discuss our future and present and job and all those things. We would discuss it.
You live in Ohio, and your son has been one of the chief antagonists for the Ohio State Buckeyes in the last 4 years. Has it been difficult?
Well, there's a lot of Ohio State fans in Ohio.
You're being kind. I must say, hey, terrific and a wonderful job with your son, and you look really spectacular this evening. Thanks for joining us.
Chris Georgia Woodson. Let's give out Heisman trophies to all four moms tonight. Well done, ladies. One man here can truly appreciate a big play flair. Maybe he hopes that Charles doesn't make a whole bunch of them in the Rose Bowl. The Cornhusker great, Johnny Rogers. He celebrates his 25th Heisman anniversary. And a man who knows all about great two-way play, the golden anniversary guy, Johnny Lujek of Notre Dame, will visit with them, as well as the remaining two finalists, as the countdown on Heisman Night 97 continues from New York City.
Happy holidays, Dave.
Same to you, Red.
I think you'll find this spicy chicken sandwich spicier than yours.
Not bad. But remember this?
Wendy's spicy chicken is seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices for that spicy hit you crave.
So?
So, you got any more in the bag?
Maybe.
Yeah. All right.
Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich. It can warm up anybody.
Hey, hey, jingle bells, jingle.
My name is Evel Knievel, and I am a professional daredevil. This January, ESPN will bring you the most colorful, thrilling televised spectacle since I jumped the fountains at Caesar's Palace back in 68. I hope you'll join me and these courageous athletes for some good old winner-take-all American entertainment. Trust me, it's gonna be a scene.
The Winter X Games, presented by Nike.
You guys yell box out is when you're out of donut. You guys remind me of my shoe closet. One penny and a bunch of loafers.
The 1940s were a banner decade for the school with the most Heisman winners. It started in 43 with quarterback Angelo Bertelli, finished up in 49 with a lineman Leon Hart, in between in 47, John Lujek, national champion three times. And was it really 25 years ago that Johnny Rogers took home the Heisman? His return against Oklahoma in the game of the century remains a highlight in the history of college football. They won the Heisman Trophy a quarter century apart, one in the post-war era, one in the Vietnam era, and college football had changed dramatically. But what these two guys share in common is that close Heisman bond. Mike?
Indeed they do, and out of deference to seniority, we'll start with Johnny Lujek. Johnny, it's been 50 years since your halcyon days in college. Are you still amazed, though, that people, when they talk about your career at Notre Dame and winning the Heisman Trophy, that they still talk in reverent terms?
Oh, I think it's terrific because, you know, this is a great family of Heisman people. And you can tell people that you played at Notre Dame, or someone can say that he was an All-American, and they really don't care. If they say that you were a Heisman winner, they say, a Heisman winner? Boy, that's terrific. So anyway, it was just terrific.
Johnny, had you ever heard of John Lujack prior to winning the Heisman Trophy?
Not prior to winning the Heisman Trophy.
I know him well since.
Did your life change appreciably because of winning the award?
Well, yes. Winning the Heisman has probably been the most significant award that I've ever won. It's probably my second greatest accomplishment that I've ever achieved, though. I was fortunate enough to receive my degree before my 25th year in broadcasting and advertising at the university with the help of the University of Nebraska athletic academic team, and that's really brought it together.
Yeah, and still one of the nattiest dressers I've ever seen. John, you know, with so much fanfare today about players going both ways, excelling on both sides of the football, that was routine back in the 40s and early 50s. You were selected in the pros with the Chicago Bears 1 year as an All-Pro as a defensive back, another year as a running back.
Yes.
You surprised at that?
Mike, I'll tell you what was great about playing both ways. If you made a few errors on offense, you still stayed on the field. You didn't have to come to the bench to have the coach tell you what you did wrong. So that was a big plus. Eh? But really, I just thought that playing both ways was just the most natural thing in the world. I hated to sit down. And as an 18-year-old sophomore at Notre Dame, I had more playing time than I did in my junior and senior year. I averaged 45 minutes.
I tell you what, you guys are both terrific to be here tonight, and it's great to see you both. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Mike.
Johnny Rogers and Johnny Lujack, Chris.
I think Johnny Rogers celebrating an even more important anniversary, the Heisman anniversary, married a year ago here at the club. And talking about old-time pro football, Washington State has had a pipeline to the pros in quarterbacks, but they've never had a guy who's had a season more successful than this guy. We'll hear from Ryan Leaf and his coach Mike Price when you come back to the DAC's Heisman Room.
Who says you can't buy taste? My clients do it all the time. Like, let's say I find the most amazing English high-back armchair. Then I better get it in front of them immediately or someone else will. That's why I value GTE Internet. In seconds, I can be online in Tampa while downloading huge files from an auction in Paris. I love shopping in Paris. Especially when it's with someone else's money.
You wouldn't expect the Diamond Store to have $99 gifts, but we do. Like these quarter-carat diamond channel hoop earrings for only $99. And this season, with any purchase of $99 or more, you can also get this delicate rose box with a pair of classic diamond earrings for just $29. Only at Zales. Or on the World Wide Web at Zales.com.
ESPN's Punt, Pass, and Sit. The ability to look off your opponent is an effective deception drill, enabling you to catch all the action of Sunday night NFL while giving the impression you care. It's ESPN's Sunday night NFL.
The long history of West Coast quarterbacks in the Heisman Trophy. Terry Baker, the first player from the West Coast to win it back in 62. In 67, Gary Beban became UCLA's first, and then Jim Plunkett, of course, in 1970. This year, a tremendous crop of quarterback talent in the Pac-10, maybe the deepest ever. But the guy at the top of that class was certainly Ryan Leaf, and the coach who coached him, maybe a perfect marriage of coach, program, and player. He's with Leaf.
You know, I'm with Mike Price, the head football coach of Washington State. Mike, you had a special relationship with Ryan Leaf. Tell us about it.
Well, first of all, he's a special person, and I like to refer to our relationship as a partnership. And we work together, and it's worked great.
You know, Ryan played like a part quarterback, part running back, part defensive linebacker.
Part linebacker. Part
everything. Tell us, what was Ryan Leaf as a football player?
Well, he's tough, number one. The toughest, one of the toughest players I've ever been around. Tough competitor. And he'll get right in your face if things aren't going right. But he plays the game because it's a game. And he's when you watch him play and when you coach with him, he's just lots of fun to be around.
How important has Ryan Leaf been to the Washington State football program?
Well, tremendous. Every time he touches the ball, he made 9 yards. You know, any kind of coach could get that other yard, couldn't he?
Yeah, I think so.
But he's meant everything to the school, to every Cougar that's ever gone to school at Washington State. It's their goal to go to the Rose Bowl, and he's taken us to the Rose Bowl. We used to compare him to Drew Bledsoe. Now everybody's going to be compared to Ryan Leaf.
Mike Price, congratulations on a great year. Good luck to you in the Rose Bowl. Chris
Lee.
Yeah, thanks. Wazoo has had two quarterbacks drafted number one overall, Jack Thompson and Bledsoe, and also a number one pick in the supplemental draft, Tim Rosenbaugh. He was Wazoo's highest Heisman finisher, seventh in 88, until Ryan Leaf. All those quarterbacks, Ryan number one in career touchdowns after his junior season. The big guy from Big Sky Country has delivered almost from day one. An athlete first, football player second, and quarterback third. Tough, aggressive, emotional, symbolic of his feisty Cougar compadres. As a passer, Ryan Leaf is a prototype, the height to spot receivers, the legs to escape defenders, and the strength to shed them, plus the arm to make any throw imaginable. Wazoo's first ever sweep of the Bruins and Trojans and long shot Rose Bowl run are probably least surprising to Leaf, who's been making bold statements since the day he arrived. Behind Leaf, Wazoo smashed the Pac-10 record for yards per game. He accounted for 39 total touchdowns and set a new yardage standard in a conference rich in quarterback tradition. In the two wins that launched and then clinched the Cougars' Rose Bowl run, Leaf passed for 739 yards and five touchdowns. Now, New Year's Day against number one Michigan will not be the first Rose Bowl that Ryan Leaf has seen. Told me last night he went a couple of years ago, volunteered to get statistics for Keith Jackson and Bob Greasy of ABC in the booth, but it was just too painful, and he vowed that day he would never go back and watch another Rose Bowl game until he could be there as a participant. He will have a slightly more important role, not ABC runner, but Washington State passer in the next Rose Bowl game. He's with Kirk.
All right, Chris. Ryan, you guys have had obviously a Cinderella story season, going to the Rose Bowl. You just heard your coach talking about you, but you and I talking last night, I know it's with you the same way. I know you feel very special about your relationship with your coach.
Oh, I do. He is the reason I am, you know. The reason I am the quarterback that I am is because of Coach Price. He has meant so much to me, to this team. He's a player's coach, and everybody respects him. And, you know, I might be his biggest recruiter out there. You know, any parents out there, if you want to send your kid to a university where your son will grow up to be a responsible, you know, young man, a winner on and off the field, and you send him to Mike Price.
I know this is an individual award, but by you just being here representing your university, I know from talking to you, it's just as important as anything.
Yeah, it is. I think it's real important that our university gets some recognition, and, you know, I'd like to bring everybody else out here, but, you know, it's good that I can, you know, say hi to them back home.
I know they came up with a Fab Five for the wide receivers, but it didn't stop there. You guys try to keep everything equal out at Pullman. The offensive line, I guess, has a nickname as well.
Yeah, they're the Fat Five. That'd be Jason, Lee, Corey, and Ryan, and Rob on the end there. And the Fab Five, you know, Sean, Kev, NT, and CJ, and then don't forget the Love, and certainly the most underrated running back in the country, Michael Black.
Getting them all in there. Last thing is, you and Charles have been hanging out. It seems like the last 4 or 5 days, you guys changing Rose Bowl game plans or anything?
Well, we exchanged our jerseys and our helmets, and I think that he's going to play quarterback, and I'm gonna play DB and see if anybody will realize what's going on.
Yeah, I think they would. Hey, good luck to you tonight. Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, Chris.
You know what? They could probably pull it off, knowing those two guys. What a salesman Ryan is. He was telling me last night about his little brother, Brady, who's behind me back here, a seventh grader, same shoe size as Ryan, size 13 shoes. Coach Price, Ryan says he's a player. Ryan's stats, you got to put them in context. It's a balanced offense they had at Washington State. They had a 1,000-yard rusher in Michael Black. So keep that in mind when you check out the amazing touchdown and yardage statistics of Ryan Leaf. Now, the 71 Rose Bowl quarterback, the 1970 Heisman Trophy winner, was, as we told you, Stanford's Jim Plunkett. He won on a 1970 landslide over a guy named Joe Theismann. And third that year was another quarterback, a guy by the name of Manning from Ole Miss. Archie ran for 6 touchdowns, threw for 14 that senior year. His Heisman run suffered when he broke his left arm late in the season, missed a couple of games, tried to play against LSU in the finale. His arm is healed up. Archie had a long NFL career, a very successful business career. But a funny thing happened. The last couple of years, he stopped being Archie Manning, football hero, and started becoming Peyton's dad. He's with Lee.
You know, Archie, you were a great football player, and all of us remember all about you, but how times have changed. How did you find out that you didn't win the Heisman?
Lee, I can't even remember. I certainly didn't come to New York, and I think somebody just called maybe the next day and said, by the way, Jim Plunkett won the Heisman. It was a very deserving winner, too.
Just like that, huh?
Yeah, I don't remember any of this fanfare going on. Nothing you like do. What Peyton's been through.
Nothing like
you.
That.
Yeah.
Describe your feeling now and how you feel about your son and his decision to stay a senior year at Tennessee.
Well, we were proud of his decision. I wanted him to make the decision. And Olivia and I knew that he put a lot of thought into it, and whatever he did was best. I had no idea maybe the impact it was had. I've had letters and people that come up to me and say they appreciate it. And I think it did make somewhat of a statement for college football. But as Peyton said, I think he said it was really selfish on his part. He wanted to play his senior year. Lee, all our prayers were answered when he just stayed healthy through his season. I thought that would have been the bummer from the decision if he had gotten hurt.
Well, people have been talking about, you know, him winning his Heisman for months. It's 15 minutes away, practically. How do you feel as a parent right now with your son sitting there and that decision coming up?
Well, it's just an exciting time, and we're proud of Peyton regardless. And it has been a long time, really, since that decision last year that people have been talking about it. I think he's kind of tired of it. He's ready for it to happen one way or the other. And we're going to be proud of him one way or the other.
Archie, congratulations.
Thank
Back
you.
To you, Chris.
Indeed. Another reason to be proud, I'm going to embarrass him here, the first student athlete in Tennessee history to graduate in 3 years, magna cum laude in speech communication with a minor in business. But he's better known in Big Orange Country as the most decorated player in Tennessee history. We'll visit with Peyton next up on Heisman Night 1997 from the DAC in NYC.
Are you looking for that red-hot gift this holiday? That gift that's hotter than hot. That special something that's on everyone's list. Then come to Wendy's and get a spicy chicken sandwich made with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. Heat up your holiday with Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich. And while you're there, say hello to Dave.
Watch the Wendy's three-tour challenge on ABC Sports December 20 and 21.
I won't go. The jungle is impenetrable. Swamps, marshes, jagged mountain ridges, icy cliffs, raging rivers, arctic winds, quicksand, dust storms, torrential rains. I stay here. But I have a Range Rover. Okay, I bring the kids.
Range Rover. No other luxury vehicle can make you this comfortable.
Dad, what's that? Dad, it's a bear.
I'll check. Everything's fine. Would a nightlight help, son?
Every day, car batteries are put to the test. And every day, America's most trusted lives up to its name. Die Hard. Tried and true.
Ha ha, Dad, very funny.
From director Steven Spielberg, Jeffrey Lyons calls Amistad unforgettable. Rolling Stone says Anthony Hopkins is sensationally good.
What this case concerns is freedom, the very nature of man.
And Siskel and Ebert give Amistad two thumbs up. Morgan Freeman, Anthony Hopkins, Jaimin Hansu, Matthew McConaughey. Amistad, rated R, now playing in select cities.
Back in New York, just a deep post pattern away from the DAC, in the middle of New York Harbor, the Statue of Liberty stands guard. We're focusing on a different pose here at the DAC tonight, maybe the second most famous statue in America, the 25-pound, 14-inch tall Frank Ilescu sculpture. 20 minutes away from the announcement of the 63rd Heisman Trophy winner. Mike Adamley has some quick info on some folks who have just been honored with their own version of a Heisman. Mike?
Well, thank you, Chris. For the fourth consecutive year, Wendy's Restaurants along teamed up with the Downtown Athletic Club with a special program that recognizes outstanding high school seniors. The nation's principals from public and private schools have selected two seniors, one male and one female, who excel in three different categories: athletics, academics, and community service. The boys finalists, there they were last night. Dave Thomas made the award, Blake Moore from Ogden, Utah. And the high school finalists, Danielle Carpenter, Kelly Coogan, Nicole Garsom Kay, Hillary Playcheck, and Hallie Shepard. And from that group, there she is, the winner, Sarah Edwards, and a reminder that the Wendy's High School Heisman can be seen on Monday, December 29th at 7:30 Eastern Time on ESPN2. And right now, a round of applause for our winners, Blake Moore and Sarah Edwards. There they are, the Wendy's High School Heisman Award winners for 1997. Chris, I have to admit one thing. Listening to their litany of accomplishments last night, I was absolutely humbled. Listening to the grade point averages, I mean, they are really spectacular individuals.
Amen. Well, how do you explain Peyton Mania if you haven't witnessed it firsthand? The mountain of fan mail, the dozens of babies born the last couple of years in Tennessee with the name Peyton, including one giraffe at the Knoxville Zoo, not to mention the fact that March 5th is forever a state holiday in Tennessee. That's the day that Peyton Manning said he would stay for his senior year. On January 2nd, against Nebraska in the Sugar Bowl, number 16 will go for win number 40 as a starting quarterback, a very rare milestone. On dear old Rocky Top, he's less football player than folk hero, Davy Crockett in cleats, Tennessee's first All-American quarterback since 1930. From the cradle, Peyton Manning was blessed and burdened with a tough last name to live up to. Expectations seemed impossibly high, but Manning more than met them, setting 40 SEC or Tennessee records, while never letting the spotlight's constant glare blur his focus on the team's goals. It wasn't easy, but when blocks were missed or passes dropped, he maintained patience and poise beyond his years, carrying the balls with 373 yards in the SEC championship game. Opponents determined to deflate the Manning hype always came away impressed and often awed. This season's 9 300-yard passing games pushed Peyton to third in all-time Division 1A yardage and fourth in touchdowns. No passer in SEC history was better at avoiding interceptions. Danny Werfel's 96 season set standards that seemed unmatchable, but in categories like yardage, completion percentage, and touchdown-to-interception ratio, Manning's 97 numbers were even better. They've got high standards at Tennessee. You can't make that opulent Hall of Fame there unless you're a first-team All-American. Peyton earned his spot there this season, the first All-American quarterback at Tennessee since 1930, Bobby Dodd, who later became the great coach. Here's our coach with the Vols coach, guys.
Yeah, I'm with Philip Fulmer, the head football coach at Tennessee. Philip, how did Peyton tell you that he was coming back for his senior year?
Lee, we were had been on a recruiting trip, very late at night, 1:15 in the morning. I get this wild phone call. Usually those phone calls aren't very good. You know that as a coach. This one was great. Woke me up from a dead sleep and said, Coach, I'm staying. And I said, Peyton, I love you. He said, Coach, let's go win them all. And we hung up. And I told Vicki at the time, I said, Vicki, I should have talked to him longer than that. And the next morning we pinched ourselves, is this real? And it was, and just the rest is history.
Tell me about Peyton Manning as a person and a player.
Well, I think the player part of it is well documented in his numbers of wins and the championship now and the number of touchdown passes and the ratio to interceptions and so on and so forth. But Peyton Manning as a person, you're talking about class, a first-class individual. You're talking about character. You're talking about integrity. You're talking about tremendous leadership for a program for 4 years as a freshman and then again all the way through his senior year. You're talking about a person that has made a commitment to college football for those 4 years and then made a tremendous commitment to the University of Tennessee in his final year and passed on the millions of dollars in the limelight of the National Football League because he enjoyed college, and that's truly the reason that he stayed and to win a championship, and he's done both of those.
Well, Philip, good luck to you in your Orange Bowl bid to beat Nebraska. Good luck, by the way.
Thank you. We'll need
Yo.
That. Thank you.
Yo. Yeah, Peyton took some heat for going to Tennessee, not following Dad to Ole Miss. Hard to blame the guy for aspiring to win championships, and Peyton's coming off the first championship ever. I'm talking Pop Warner, high school or college. Looked like a lot of fun. He's back there with Kirk.
Chris, I thank you. Right now, Peyton, you look back at this, and you and I have talked about this, but you had a chance to come back for your senior year. You win the SEC championship, still a chance for the national championship. You're here tonight. Was it all worth it?
Absolutely, Kirk. I really came back to create some more memories, and I had a lot of fun playing with my teammates this year, making some more friends off the team, and the SEC championship on Saturday night was really special.
You know, through the media, we've been hearing a lot about your relationship with your dad, but I know your mom and you have a great relationship. Talk to us about that.
Well, we do. She's been great throughout all these tough decisions, whether it was deciding to come to Tennessee or deciding to stay in college. She's been unbelievably supportive of me throughout these tough times, and I'm really grateful for her.
You guys, you and your brother spent I don't know how many hours in the backyard and your pads playing backyard football, and I know winning this award tonight would not only mean a great deal to you, but to your whole family.
Well, my family's been so supportive of me. My two brothers, Eli and Cooper, have been so, been there for me through all the tough times. And Cooper's my real inspiration in life. He's had some health problems these past few years, and really proud he could be here tonight.
Congratulations. Good luck to you.
Thank you, Kurt.
All right. Chris?
Well, if Manning wins, he'd become the second consecutive SEC quarterback to win a Heisman Trophy. Let's test your knowledge of trivia here. The last time, different players, same conference, same position, won Heisman's in back-to-back years. You got to go back to 1954 and 55. The late Alan Ameche of Wisconsin. I know technically he was a fullback. And then in 55, Ohio State's Hopalong Cassidy, a two-way legend of the Big Ten. Couple of decades before Charles Woodson was born. We'll visit with him. The announcement is looming from New York.
Make your holiday list, then head to Menards. Find great gifts, including showerheads by Teledyne Waterpik. This model is only $14.98. This flexible showerhead features six relaxing settings, $29.97. Give a skill power tool to the handy person on your list. Circular saws are just $32.98 after rebate. Powerful jigsaws, $49.96. Find great gifts and holiday trimmings at Menards.
Warm seasons greetings to you all from Menards.
Why, hello! Ho, ho, ho! Welcome to the North Pole! Ho, ho! Why, it's me, Santa Claus! Ho, ho, ho! Great Googly Wigglies! It's nice to be back in TV land! Ho, ho! Mm. Ho, ho, ho! Merry Christmas!
Basically just the same guy I was when I was growing up in Walla Walla. All this attention, the money, it just doesn't matter to me. You know, I'd just rather get together with some buddies and go fishing.
Gucci watch?
Yeah, I bought it in the Caribbean.
St. John's?
No, St. Bart's. I just got a villa down there. They got the best French cuisine down there. Dishwasser to die for. The
French people make great wine.
Yeah, they do, but you've got to try a Tuscan Chianti. Awesome. Love it.
Last night in New York, the three finalists who were here, Peyton Manning was accepting an award elsewhere, out on the town in New York City, experiencing the holiday hustle and bustle, going to the Hard Rock Cafe and getting a taste of gridlock. It might be easier to win a Heisman than get a cab this time of year in New York City. Moments away from now, the final four. Some sweaty palms in the front row. Everybody says no. I can speak, I think, for the parents. They feel a little bit differently. Well, there were some great college football players in 97 who had excellent seasons but didn't quite have the Heisman votes to get here, including a number of junior running backs. Ricky Williams at Texas, the nation's leading ground gainer, gained also respect on the strength of 200-yard rushing games, ran with heart even though Texas had a bad year. Amon Green, a big part of Nebraska's perfection, 11 straight 100-yard games. And Curtis Enos, he was Penn State's offensive leader, started slowly, finished with a flourish, 8 straight 100-yard games. If any of those guys return next year, they'll be among the favorites in 1998. Now, back in 1955, there was no question the dominant running back in the country, but he was more than just a running back, a huge legend. He's with Mike Adamo.
Well, over the years, Chris, college football has given us a lot of colorful nicknames, from the Galloping Ghost, Red Grange, to the Tyler Rose, Earl Campbell. In 1955, as you mentioned, a nickname that was the scourge of the Big Ten, Ohio State's outstanding Heisman Trophy winning running back, Howard Hopalong Cassidy, who joins us now. First of all, the nickname, and you did get it from William Boyd, yes?
Yes, I did. Another Buckeye. I got his nickname, but I didn't get his money.
You know, what people forget is you were an outstanding running back, but also a great defensive back as well. And again, the same question we asked John Lujack. The fanfare over today's player, and again, the game has changed a lot in terms of specialization, but are you surprised that people are making such a big to-do about people who go both ways and play on both sides of the football, considering that was the norm back in the 40s and 50s?
Yeah, it was great. You know, you get to play all the time. If you lose the ball, you have to get it back yourself, and it's so much more fun to me to play both ways. I just love defense. I really did, and we had great running backs when I played right along with me that were, you know, were as good as I was or anything, you know, and outstanding football players, and they were great on defense, too. It's just a lot more fun, I felt then.
Hop along real quickly as we send it back to Chris. Fact or fiction, in your 4 years of Big Ten competition, nobody completed a pass over you?
I intercept the most of them.
We'll let it rest right there, Chris.
As the years go by, you get better and better. All these guys are going to find that out. When you come back to the Downtown Athletic Club, we'll have the announcement you've been waiting for, the 63rd Heisman Trophy winner, the four finalists, all great seasons. Only one man can leave this building with the famous statue. The announcement just minutes away now.
Critics call it a startling blast of thrills. Rolling Stone calls it a visual marvel. And People magazine says Alien Resurrection rocks.
Is it everything you hoped for?
Must be a chick thing.
Rated R, now playing.
Let me check.
Lee Riveted, the new look of Lee.
Critics call it a startling blast of thrills. Rolling Stone calls it a visual marvel. And People magazine says Alien Resurrection rocks.
Is it everything you hoped for?
Must be a chick thing.
Rated R, now playing.
Professor Sterling Sharp is conducting research at Bristol University's Theoretical Football Laboratory.
The computer's running various scenarios based on if the United States was invaded by Canada. And consequently, the CFL absorbed the NFL.
And what about the 110-yard field differential? Do it again.
Professor Sharp.
Yes.
The results of the Brett Favre staying in Atlanta scenario.
Interesting. June Jones named Coach of the Year.
The moment is just about here. A reminder that all of these players were on teams that won conference championships and at least 10 games. Their teams have had brilliant seasons. But only one man each year can win it. We've reached the moment. The talking is about done. First, I want to have a warm thank you to the Downtown Athletic Club's Heisman Committee Chairman, Bill Blum. Thank you, sir. We are delighted at ESPN that our partnership with the DAC will continue well into the next millennium to bring you this announcement. And now the moment, the president of the Downtown Athletic Club, the man with the envelope, Peter Young.
Thank you,
Peter.
Thank you, Chris. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the entire membership of the Downtown Athletic Club of New York City, its officers, its governors, the Heisman Committee, who have worked so diligently to preserve the prestige and integrity of the Heisman tradition and of this club. It is my honor to present for the 63rd time the Heisman Memorial Trophy Award, arguably the most recognized individual award in all of amateur sport, to the most outstanding collegiate football player in the United States, 1997. And the winner. From Michigan, Charles Woodson.
Of course, you better go down and say hi to Mom, huh?
This is big. First of all, I have to thank the Lord because to receive this honor, the Heisman Trophy, the highest award given to a college football player, he's been there with me all my life, and I just thank you for this opportunity to be here, for a chance to win this award. I mean, I was sitting there in that chair, and I was just thinking to myself, you know, do I really have a shot? And I kept thinking about the Rocket Ismail and the Ty Detmer year and how everybody thought the Rocket was going to win it, but they opened the envelope, and Ty Detmer got it. Not to take anything away from Ty, but it's, like I said, a great honor to be up here. I want to thank the Downtown Athletic Club for inviting me here. Thanks to all the voters, everyone who thought I was worthy enough to win this award. I want to say thanks to my mother, the greatest lady alive, I believe. I want to say thanks to my dad for being there for me. My brother who's back there, and my friend Marcus who made it here. Thanks to everybody back at home in Fremont, Ohio, where I grew up, where it all started. Just want to say thanks to all those people. I used to always tell everybody when I was younger that I would win the Heisman Trophy. But when I started my defensive days at the University of Michigan, that dream kind of left. But you guys have brought that dream back. It gave me a chance earlier in the season, putting me in the race, and allowing me the chance to be here, and putting me with a great group of guys, Dorsett, Archie Griffith, Rozier, and everybody else. Just want to say thanks. This is truly the biggest moment in my life so far, and thanks a lot.
And a little piece of history. Charles Woodson, the first prominently defensive player to win the Heisman Trophy. We'll talk to him and review the voting when we come back to New York.
Happy holidays, Dave.
Same to you, Red.
I think you'll find this spicy chicken sandwich spicier than yours.
Not bad. But remember this?
Wendy's spicy chicken is seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices for that spicy hit you crave.
So,
you got any more in the bag?
Maybe.
Yeah. All right.
Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich. It can warm up anybody.
Hey, jingle bells, jingle.
You there, lad. Is it still the holidays?
Yeah. Where you been, pal?
I'm not too late. I can still get presents. But where?
Office Max. They've got loads of great gifts. Attachés, pens, software.
Intelligent lad.
At guaranteed low prices, so you don't waste time shopping around.
Delightful, lad. Hurry to Office Max and start my shopping.
Couldn't we just charge it? Office Max. We go to the max for you.
American Airlines is proud to be the official airline of the Heisman Memorial Trophy Award. Together with American Eagle, American serves over 300 cities worldwide. American Airlines, something special in the air. The Heisman Trophy presentation is presented by Wendy's Delicious Spicy Chicken Sandwich. It'll make you feel warm all over.
Your 63rd Heisman Trophy winner is Charles Woodson of Michigan. Here is the final balloting. Peyton Manning, the fourth player from Tennessee to be runner-up. Ryan Leaf, third. Randy Moss, fourth. Charles carrying five of the six regions. My friend, when did you start dreaming that this was possible? Was it the Penn State game when folks started to take notice of you as an offensive player as well as a corner?
Well, really not until the Ohio State game when the people started really saying that I was closing the margin on Peyton Manning. And that was really when I started thinking that, hey, I might have a shot at it.
And when you returned that punt against the Buckeyes, you told me afterward you wanted to strike the pose, but you were too tired and your teammates got there too quick. You want to strike the pose now?
Oh, I love to strike the pose for the people out there. No.
Yeah. Let's see the pose. You ready? You got it. Are you sure you haven't practiced that?
No, I haven't practiced.
I think somewhere there are defensive players out there who are saying, about time. Let's take a look at the regional breakdown. Regional factors, perhaps not quite as important this year as in other years in the Northeast region. Charles winning with a margin of 314 points to Peyton Manning's 273. Ryan Leaf doing pretty well out of his region in the Mid-Atlantic. A little bit closer, 305 to 240 is the margin there. In the Midwest, of course, Charles Woodson's home region, and the voters going with him in a strong manner there, 355 to 218. In the South, Peyton Manning does carry that region, as Danny Werfel did last year, but not enough. In the Southwest, another region for Charles Woodson with 339 points. And in the Far West, Charles Woodson over Ryan Leaf, the quarterback of Washington State, coming up second place right there. You're carrying the flag for defensive players. You know you're starting a trend right now. Every guy in America is going to want to play corner, then want to play receiver and return punts and get right here where you are.
Well, I think it opens up doors. But, I mean, for me, I play defense and offense. But if I played just defense, I probably wouldn't really have a shot at it. But, like I said, it's truly a great honor. I'm glad to be here and happy to be a 1997 Heisman Trophy winner.
Move over Tom Harmon and Desmond Howard. There's now a third Michigan man in the Heisman Trophy Club. Congratulations once again to Charles Woodson.